Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Leadership and Politics. Dr. Abraham. On the show with me today is the award-winning author, Mr. Larry Robertson. Larry, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here, Dr. Abe.
I was looking forward to this, and I'm so happy that we finally put it together. Again, welcome. Before we go into your book, Rebel Leadership, can you introduce yourself a little bit about who you are, as much as you're comfortable with, what you do?
Sure. Go ahead. I would be happy to. I'll just kind of give you the framework. I think of myself as an innovation advisor, and I work at the nexus of three topic areas: creativity, entrepreneurship, and leadership. And I'm a big believer that not only are those important and attractive skill sets, but to raise your odds of success in any one of them, you really need all three. You need to combine creativity with entrepreneurial thinking and leadership. So that's really the focus of much of my work, my research, my writing, also my advisory work. I'm also a Fulbright scholar, just recently named in the last month.
Nice.
And I'm the author of, thank you very much. I'm the author of two other award-winning books and a columnist for a number of publications, Inc. Magazine, The Creativity Post, Thrive Global, CEO World, and a couple of others. My latest book, which you referred to, is called Rebel Leadership, How to Thrive in Uncertain Times. And that's due out June 1st. And it really takes all of that knowledge I just described that's underneath what I do and the expertise that's there, but it points it at this new and very VUCA, volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous world that we now all occupy, and ask the question, how do we lead in such a world? And then answers in ways I think are really helpful and also proven. So that's a little bit about me.
It's very nice. So if you put the deliberate pause, language of man, and rebel leadership, so if you're creating a stage, rebel leadership would be one of these pillars that your philosophy is built on.
Almost think of it as a trilogy, because
trilogy,
in some ways,
yes,
they point to one another. I won't tell you that I would be misleading if I said that was the plan from the beginning, but really one beget the other or beg the other to be talked about. The very first book I wrote, which you referred to, A Deliberate Pause, and the subtitle of that is Entrepreneurship and Its Moment in Human Progress, was really an exploration of what I had studied, what I advised about, what I had researched for 2.5 decades at that time. And what I kept encountering situations where even people who referred to themselves as entrepreneurs, or people who marketed themselves as experts in entrepreneurship, whether they were entrepreneurs or advisors to them or investors, would pull me aside after I would do talks and ask quite honestly, but quite sheepishly, what is entrepreneurship? And so it's one of those terms that we admire, that we use a lot, and we rarely explore what it means. So my first book was really peeling back, what is it? Who's really behind it, and what leads to lasting impact. But as you probably know from your own work, especially in the classroom, but elsewhere in what you do, at the beginning of entrepreneurship is something else. And that's really that ability to think in a creative way, to think in an innovative way, to be open, to look at problems unlike others have looked at it, to pursue a path boldly that others haven't. So really, it kind of called for The Language of Man, which was my second book. And the subtitle of that is Learning to Speak Creativity. And similarly, The Language of Man took a step back and said, let's not assume we know what creativity is. That still today, which I sometimes scratch my head finding this hard to believe, the dominant belief among people, there are two dominant beliefs among people about creativity. One is that it's only what happens in the arts. And the arts is just one place and one area where you manifest creative thought into all sorts of outputs. And the second thing people predominantly believe is that only some handful are creative and the rest of us are not. And I'm a big believer that really it's the case that most of us are told we're not creative when really all of us are. So that second book really went back in time. In fact, I looked at papers and writings and research that went back 2 centuries and then pulled forward to the future to say, what are the patterns across creativity, no matter where it occurs? And how do we really best tap that kind of thinking that's there in each one of us from childhood and kind of gets covered up along the way. And both of those really led to rebel leadership. I think the thing that pushed me over the line to write the third book was looking at these times we're living in. These are very, very uncertain times. And when I say that, I'm not talking about the pandemic. The pandemic is one example, it's one outgrowth, but really the first 20 years of this new century have been increasingly uncertain. And they're uncertain in a very different way than we're used to. You know, if you think about uncertainty, it can slowly rise in a situation like a tide. It can also come quickly and overtake you like a sudden storm surge. Yes. What we have now in this period of time is a sustained period where both things are occurring. And the implications are really important because if you think just about risk, we tend to think of risk in conventional ways. So it's more risk that comes with the uncertainty that's like a slowly rising tide. It's the kind of thing that when it arrives, it's unfamiliar to us, but pretty soon we can get our head around it and then we can get our arms around it. And then we come up with a new way of doing that mitigates that risk and returns us to a kind of status quo. But what we're increasingly dealing with is what a lot of people refer to as complex risk. So this is risk that intertwines from place to place, person to person, organization to organization. It's happening at all levels, the individual level, the organizational level, the societal level, even the environmental level. And it's risk that we can't often see and that is moving all the time. So I think it quite naturally says this has some pretty serious implications for leadership. And if you look at research among leaders, leadership surveys, CEO surveys, and things of that nature, you can see the evidence that this is really hard for most leaders to deal with. So for example, about 2 years ago, PwC did a CEO survey. They do this annually. They've done it for 20 years. And 4 in 5 CEOs, this was almost 2,000 people interviewed, said that in every sense, when they thought about the future, their future as leaders, the future of technology and how they deal with that, how they hire, even where their revenues are going to come from, they used one word to describe how they felt about all those things: unpredictable. And what's even more interesting is if you look at those PwC surveys over the past 20 years, that theme is increasingly there, rising to that point where 4 in 5 say, I find this unpredictable. And McKinsey backed it up last year. They surveyed 2,500 senior level executives across industries, even across countries. And they asked them about their confidence of, could you even keep the level of performance you have now or exceed it in the future? And 92% said they weren't sure they could. So there are indicators out there that say, this is a very different kind of uncertainty that we're dealing with. And that it has a significant impact on leadership. And that's what led me to look at that third book.
To the third book, Rebel Leadership.
Yeah, let's look across all these things, creativity and entrepreneurship and leadership, and look at them in the context of an uncertain world.
Excellent. Excellent. I love this introduction. Now, you're not only a talented author and writer, which I love your writing, but you're also an eloquent speaker, which make people mesmerized to listen to you. So I'm glad that happened. But let me ask you a few questions here.
Please.
Just a follow-up. Now, when we talk about uncertainty, we call those in academia and unprogrammed decisions. When there have two types of decisions making processes, which one is programmed, which we already know the steps for. An emergency, what you do, you take the steps, don't take the elevators. The unprogrammed is this, these are where uncertainty comes into play. And most leaders, they don't know what to do because they have no step-by-step process. So they use their intuition, they use their know-how, their experience, some feedback. And this is what make a leader from others. But let me go back to three things I want you to define for me, for us. In a deliberate pause, you talk about entrepreneurship and entrepreneurs. Define entrepreneurship in general, what it is, what is it, and then what makes a good entrepreneur. Then I'm going to go back to the language of man. We talk about it, creativity. Define that to me in your own words. And I want you to talk more about from you. I want you to more from that to innovation.
Sure.
What's the difference between the two? And then we go back to the rebel leadership after that.
Sure. I'd be happy to. So What I'll do is I'll try to address each one of those in brief. And then if you'd like to dig in, please let me know. So I find it very interesting that the real definition of an entrepreneur or entrepreneurship is to undertake in something, whatever it is. It doesn't necessarily mean it's a business. If it is an organization, it doesn't necessarily mean it's a for-profit organization, but to undertake in such a way that you believe in what you're undertaking so much so that you're almost placing yourself as a surety on what you're doing because you are so committed to seeing it through. That's really the original definition of what an entrepreneur is. A lot of the early writing about entrepreneurship was written by economists. And so it very early on got a heavy overtone of business, small business, so on. And to be sure, entrepreneurship occurs in a business setting, but it occurs in a lot of different settings. So when you ask, you know, what is an entrepreneur and what really makes for that person or that undertaking that we talk about, I think that's the most crucial thing to understand. The second thing is that entrepreneurship is never about a single idea. It's about an accumulation of ideas. So as ideas build on one another, they not only morph and change the ideas before them or come together to become something new, sometimes they completely obliterate what the original idea was. So it's this progressive thing. And when you realize that, it comes to kind of the third piece that I think is really critical when you think about entrepreneurship. It's never just about one person. It's never just about the entrepreneur. And if you think just about those ideas that need to keep coming and morphing and building on one another, really to do that consistently takes many people. So the best entrepreneurs out there not only understand that they are undertaking in this larger way, which, by the way, allows them to define value and how they create value in a much broader and more important sense. It's not just about profitability. That's gasoline, that's a fuel or a driver for what they do in many cases, but it's something bigger that they're going for in terms of value, which means they need that continuous flow of ideas, which means they need others to be along with them, not just as employees, but as active participants in pursuing that undertaking. That's how I look at entrepreneurship.
Good. What distinguishes one leader that with an entrepreneurship spirit than another? Give me the characteristics of it.
So I used to teach a class at Georgetown's business school, at the McDonough School, about understanding entrepreneurship. That's what it was called. And one of the things that I would do is, in addition to what we did as class exercises and some lecture I did, I would regularly bring in guest speakers. And they couldn't have been more different from one another. So in some cases, they were very loud and bold. In other cases, they were the quietest people you ever would have met. You know, the people who make you feel like they're pausing a full 60 seconds before they answer a question. They're so thoughtful and measured with their words. There were people who had many degrees of education and people who had only up to a high school education, people who came from wealthy backgrounds, people who came from very poor backgrounds. The reason I say all that is that there is no set profile for what makes a successful entrepreneur in terms of personality traits and things of that nature, even the background. It's much more, I believe, and my research shows, this broader understanding of what the entrepreneurial undertaking is, what it takes to make it successful in the first place, and most importantly, what allows you to have impact over time. And one of the key things that does come down to the individual level is the ability of that individual entrepreneur, the person who kicks things off, who gets things started, who takes those bold moves when, you know, nobody wants to back him or her, when they realize that being an entrepreneur is very different than being a leader. And when they can evolve to be that leader, and when they can cultivate that entrepreneurial mindset in others, and in fact, leadership in others, those tend to be the individuals who take their venture or take their idea the furthest and have the most lasting impact.
I like it. So they think outside the box?
I think they absolutely do. In fact, the term I use for it is openness. But it's openness in this much more significant way. It's not just openness enough to come up with the original idea, but openness ongoing that there might be a better way to do things, that the assumptions you once had might have changed. There's this actually comes from my second book, The Language of Man, The Focus on Creativity. But for that book, I interviewed nearly 70 MacArthur Fellows. And this is the MacArthur Fellowship, for those of your listeners who don't know it, is what's sometimes called the Genius Award. It's the only award for creativity in the broadest sense. It's not something these fellows apply for. It's kind of bestowed upon them. One of the MacArthur Fellows I interviewed was an education reformer named Deborah Meyer. And Deb used to talk about how when she ran anything, the evolution of a new idea, the turnaround of a school, even just the management of a project or onboarding a new employee, they would always employ what she called the five habits of the mind. And the five habits of the mind are five questions. And the questions are, how do we know what we know? Is there a pattern? Some form of the question, what if? The fourth habit is there another way? And the fifth and final one is, who cares? And so entrepreneurs that have that kind of thinking ongoing in their own head, but also in the cultures of the organizations they build, where they look at that first question and say, how do we know what we know? And they're reconsidering their assumptions. Sometimes their assumptions are perfectly fine, but that openness to be there to see something new when it occurs or something old when it fades away and becomes irrelevant is critical. To then look for patterns, not just anomalies, to from there build into the what ifs, to even challenge a great idea by asking, is there another way? And to always keep the focus on who cares and are we driving towards that? That's what I think allows an entrepreneur to stay fresh and their venture to go far.
Love it. Let's talk about the openness. How do you build openness? Is that something you create? Is that something you build on? Is that something innate? Is it part of the personality?
It's a really good question. So I think of openness as a practice.
Okay.
And it doesn't mean that, I don't think that it's really relevant whether someone is born more or less open, because really right from the moment they're born, something is shaping their degree of openness. So if you fast forward to adulthood, no matter where you start in terms of openness, the practice of it is what allows you to become skilled at it, allows you to become comfortable with something else that often comes with openness, which is discomfort. Because openness means you're looking at things other than what you know now and other than what you do, and that can be uncomfortable. The best way to practice openness and to become really skilled at it is to make it collective, to invite others into that process so that it's not just you challenging your own ideas or your own way of doing, but you're putting that challenge together with one another and towards a shared purpose or a common end. That tends to be where openness is at its best. Because if you think about it, if you're bringing people together in that way, you're asking them to think in an open way, there's a higher likelihood that they're going to bring the diversity of their thought and their experiences. And so everybody's going to see it a little bit different. And that's actually what leans heavily towards innovation, is that practice of being open and exploring at all those edges across all those diverse viewpoints.
What would you do to limit or have others exit your environment when you see them, they're trying to take away that drive that you have?
Yeah, it's interesting. So things, openness is something that becomes cultural. And culture is hard work, whether you're talking about the openness aspect of it or the sensitivity to where people are coming from, the sensitivity to diversity and a range of perspectives. It is constant work. I interviewed a lot of chief diversity officers for Rebel Leadership, and the diversity, inclusion, and equity office in organizations now is becoming a central point for strategy in the organization, not just having diversity, but how do we go about tapping that? And one of the people I talked to was Russell Schaefer, who's a very senior level guy in global culture and diversity at Walmart. And he was very quick to point out, culture is what we're doing right now. It is not what we did. It is not what we aspire to. It's what we are in this moment. So it's that constant practice. And sometimes that has rough edges, including when it comes to openness. It's really interesting to me, Dr. Abe, you had a very powerful guest in one of your classes recently, Gary Ridge, the CEO and chairman of WD-40. And he was asked a very similar question by one of your students. What do you do if somebody is just not into that openness, or they become rigid about it? And I loved his answer, and so I'm going to borrow from it. He said, one of the most important things is you try to clarify that on the way in. So when you're interviewing those people, when you're thinking about hiring them, you're telling them, you're exposing them to the culture, including the level of openness. Once you invite them in, and this is where I'll expand on what he said, it can't be just words. It's turning over the keys to them so that they can see not just the vulnerability of openness, but the benefit, the power of openness, whether you're the person asking the questions about where an organization is and where it might go, or you're the person who's, I'll go ahead and use the phrase, on the hot seat, where you could get uncomfortable. And so you're answering those questions. If you're experiencing that range, you may still be uncomfortable with openness, but at least you know it's part of the expectation. At least you know it's part of the game. And most importantly, you know that you are empowered to be a full participant in it. I think in most cases that quells a lot of that, but sometimes people and organizations change. And I think one thing leaders are not really great about and organizations are not really great about is realizing that sometimes people leave. And so being tuned into how you might adapt things so they can stay, but also have very open conversations about whether or not the fit remains, is as important to keeping that openness environment.
They can stay within the circle, otherwise they have to exit, right?
I think that's always the case. It's just a hard reality to put your arms around because it means change in another way. Nobody likes goodbyes. They don't always go well, but it's a reality.
It's a reality. Now let's go to the second definition I want, creativity. In the language of man, you talk about creativity. Give me your own definition and then take me into innovation. Because I want to link the deliberate pause into the language of man, which you successfully did, but I want to do them through definitions. So we can go back and talk about rebel leadership.
Sure. I'd love to do that. So one of the biggest mistakes we make about creativity is we tend to think of creativity when we go to define it as the output. And there are certainly outputs of creativity, and those are certainly the things that we're enamored with, whether it's a piece of art, it's a new business model, it's a cure for some disease. All of those are outputs, but creativity is an ability. And it's an ability that's built into every single human being. We're born creative, we're born curious, we're born as explorers. And if you watch virtually any toddler or infant or crawling baby, you will see that they not only are curious and explore, but when they find something that doesn't quite go their way, that doesn't stop them from exploring. When kids hit kindergarten and first grade, we start to layer on a lot of expectations about what they're supposed to do, about what good performance is, a letter grade A or B or whatever that might be, even a way to go about doing things. And so it doesn't mean we eliminate creativity, this natural skill that everybody has. It means we get very much out of practice with it. And the older we become, the more situations we find ourselves in where somebody is telling us there is a way. And this is the way, and this is how we will judge your performance. So creativity for me is tapping back into that natural ability to see beyond whatever it is you do right now or how you do it, simply to explore the possibilities. One of the other MacArthur fellows I interviewed, is a gentleman by the name of Stu Kaufman, talks about this idea of the adjacent possible. And what he's really saying is that all of us, whether we realize it or not, in any point in our lives, work within a zone where we kind of have this invisible fence around us. And inside are the things we know. Inside are the way we do things that we're familiar and comfortable with, even the people that we know and the settings that we know. The adjacent possible is something that lies just beyond the edge of that. And what Stu says is, if you're willing to even just put your toe across the line, you enter this new space where you can't help but see things in a different way. Are they going to be dramatically different? Are you going to come up with the brilliant, innovative idea just by putting your toe across one time? Probably not. But by repeatedly doing that, you can't help but see things different in a different zone. More powerful, when you come back into your familiar zone, you also see that zone in a different way. And then the true power of the adjacent possible, according to Stu, is the more you go back and forth between the two, the more you're willing to be open and step outside your comfort zone, even in small ways, to make it habitual, to practice it, you actually expand the zone of possibilities. So just this idea of tapping back into who we are naturally in small ways, but in regular practice, that's how I think about creativity. And when you link it to innovation, it's that way that you're putting yourself in new situations that really leads to thoughts that become innovative in their context and then lead to those outputs we so often focus on that are what we call innovations, the things themselves. This whole idea of stepping into your creative zone and out of your naturally comfortable zone. One of my favorite stories about that came from a guy I interviewed actually for my first book, A Deliberate Pause, a gentleman by the name of Richard Tate. So Richard had worked for Microsoft for years and he had started companies within Microsoft. Among them, probably he's best known for creating Expedia. Richard left Microsoft and he decided to start with a partner, a new company called Cranium. And Cranium, I don't know if you remember it, but it's a board game. And Cranium reinvented the board game. That market had basically flattened, and Richard and his partner believed there was a way to open it back up. And when I asked Richard how he tapped into his creative zone, the very first example he gave me was every day when he went to lunch, he walked a different way. So even if it was walking to the left side of a tree versus the right side of a tree, or going around a different block to get to the same deli than the one he'd taken before, doing that opened up his mind in ways that he didn't even appreciate until he continued to make it a pattern. And the other thing he would do whenever he would go a different way to lunch is he would try to have a different encounter with somebody, hopefully he didn't know, but with people he would have otherwise not paid attention to. So again, think about that deli. He's standing in line. There's somebody in front of him he doesn't even know. And he says, wow, what an interesting name for that sandwich up there. You know, the Seattle special. Have you tried that? Or it might just be smiling at someone. And so it's these tiny moves that move you into this zone you're less familiar with. These tiny moves that move you outside of the mindset that you're very familiar with that lead to an expansion of creative capacity and ultimately lead to innovation.
Innovation, I like it. The more you move out of this comfort zone, the more your comfort zone expands.
That's right.
You have
that's really, exactly right.
That's what you do is you expand that comfort zone and then new thoughts and ideas come into that original comfort zone that you have. And now you have other things to think about and that will make you think and think. And you
absolutely.
And repeat the process again and again.
And here's a strange example of this. This is what elite athletes do. So there's actually an increasing study in the area of peak human performance. And one of the common starting points is looking at elite athletes. So if you think about, you know, the most elite athletes we know, take somebody like Tiger Woods and all that he achieved early in his career. At some point, what made Tiger Woods so great early on began to be challenged. It began to be challenged by competition. It began to be challenged by the problems he had with his back and his body as he grew older. And so it presented this choice. Do I continue to try to force peak performance by being what I've always been? Or do I start to play at the edges or play boldly with how I do things and possibly open that up to new possibilities? So one of the things Tiger Woods is most famous for was more than once in his career, completely reinventing his swing. And in doing it, he threatened his ability to win the way he always had, but he also expanded his ability to win in new ways that were more fitting to his circumstances at the time, whether that was competition or his own body or whatever it might be. The interesting thing about that is that it takes a huge degree of openness to embrace what really leads to peak performance. And the second thing the research shows is it not only takes that openness on an ongoing basis, but it takes this willingness to extreme to experience and to deal with discomfort sometimes in the extreme. And he is a great example because he experienced both. Twice when he reinvented his swing, it worked, and he went on to win other tournaments. And the last time he did, it didn't work so well. So this whole idea of being open is something that takes this ongoing practice, and it comes with this discomfort. It's interesting to look at elite athletes and then think about, well, what would that look like for me, you know, in the workplace or among colleagues or as the leader of an organization? I think there are a lot of different ways to slice that.
I like it. Actually, I like that you use him as an example, because that's going to lead to the follow-up question I have. So you mentioned we are innately creative, right?
Yes.
As we know, you and I, we know innovation. There, without creativity, there is no innovation. Innovation comes as a result of creativity. For the research to lead us, and as you're telling us, creativity is innately with us. Now, the question to you, and you used Tiger, which is excellent. Tiger had his father with him, major part of his life until he became professional. And then he became in his own and he created his own things. And probably every move he did is an innovation after that, because he's creative natural. Now, the question to you is, whose responsibility is it to cultivate this creativity that we have? Is it parents, schools, education systems? Whose responsibility is it? Since we have it innately, how do you build on it?
Yeah, it's that's a very powerful question. And I would say that ultimately that responsibility falls on the individual
to correct.
So this is where it's difficult. So, and you're young more than once in your life, right? So you're young before you, when you're preschool, right? And you have your parents and your environment around you. So parents can play a significant role in enabling a child to lean towards their natural openness, to lean towards their natural curiosity, or to curb it. It doesn't mean it's not there, but parents can help with that practice. Following them are teachers. Teachers have a substantial role to play in that, even when they are required by, if we're talking like K through 12, their school districts, their principal, their superintendent, whatever it is, to meet certain requirements. For a teacher within those to look for opportunities to show a child that there's more than one way to think about something, that there's more than one right answer, there's more than one way to get to any answer, and it's okay to be wrong, can be hugely powerful for an individual. But again, we're young again when we get to college and when we get to our first job. And so professors and bosses, they play that role as well. Somewhere along the way, an individual, when they're able to really register it, needs to be exposed to that reality that they are innately creative, that they have that capacity, that what their form of it is not going to look like everybody else's. But the most important thing is to practice it. They need that exposure. After that, I think it becomes an individual responsibility to find the environments in which you best can do that. But you're absolutely right. There is no question that other people have that responsibility along the way in creating that environment where you can tap and practice that ability.
Tap and practice. I think you and I, we just found the title of your fourth book, Stages of... Stages of Creativity. And that's going to probably the audience would be the parents and teachers. And so we can, because you just eloquently stated what it is. And
it's interesting what the roles are. Yeah. And if you think about those roles, just as much as we all tend to get locked into thinking of innovation or creativity as the output, the roles you can play along the way as a parent, as a teacher, as a boss, as a leader in any form and in any sense, are so powerful, but they don't come with a script either. So in opening people up to their own creativity, in opening them up to the practice of openness and things like that, it's giving them the environment in which to make their own choices and pursue their own path that is the most powerful thing. And I think there's a natural tendency for all of us to fall into the formula view of creativity and innovation versus what I think of as the framework view. It's that framework and those reference points and making it a habit and a mindset and a practice that are far more important than whatever the outcome is.
Nicely said. Let's talk about rebel leadership. Give me the premise of the book. And who are your audience, or who's your audience?
So let me start with the premise of the book, because I think that helps to define the audience. the premise of the book is what I referred to earlier, that we now live in what I refer to as a new abnormal, where uncertainty isn't a variable. It's the norm. It's the constant in our lives. And it comes in forms we expect, and it comes in forms we don't. If you live in that kind of environment, one of the key skills that you need to develop is adaptability, not just as an individual, but as organizations. Both of those things, the uncertain environment and the need to adapt as a matter of habit, really have a big impact on how we lead. So we're often taught about leadership as though it occurs or should occur in very formulaic ways, that there are certain types of leaders, that there's a certain way to lead, certain models for leading. But in an uncertain environment, and when you're constantly adapting, those just don't hold up. So the real premise of the book is that we often come to think of the leader equaling leadership. That individual person at the top almost represents leadership in total, and nothing could be further from the truth. Leadership as well is a very innate human skill. We use it in different ways. We lead in different ways. We're not all going to be the CEO of whatever it might be. But at the same time, we lead because we want to achieve. We want to have an impact of others. We want to feel a sense of mastery about what we do. And we want to have an impact. If you look over 40 years of research, those are what people strive for most in whatever they do. It's less the financial things or the title they get. And so if you think about that in the context of an uncertain environment, then you really have to change your definition of leadership. So what I did for Rebel Leadership was to realize that in this uncertain environment, most leaders are struggling. Most organizations are still trying to figure it out. However, there are a lot of organizations that are thriving in these uncertain times. So what I did was look across organizations from a wide range, from Airbnb to Warby Parker to the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, Walmart, Microsoft, Hello Sunshine, which is Reese Witherspoon's production company, yes. The Icelandic men's national soccer team. So you see the range and the diversity there. What's interesting is that all of those organizations are thriving in uncertainty, and all of them follow similar patterns. So the book is really about what are those patterns? What do they mean, and how do they come together so that anybody can thrive in uncertain times? That's really what Rebel Leadership's focus is.
Rebel Leader, is that something you coined, or does it exist?
No, it's at least in my knowledge base, it's not a term that existed. It's one that I coined, and my meaning in Rebel Leadership is that...
Give me the mindset as well. Give me the mindset.
That's correct.
Okay, go ahead.
Is really a sum of the two parts. So, you know, rebel is often something we admire and we attribute to entrepreneurs and to creative people. But if it was just about coming up with new ideas or disrupting the status quo or being adaptable, then, you know, risk takers and people being rebellious just for the sake of rebellious might be enough, but it's not enough. Then there are downsides to it. If just leading people according to a plan, leading them to a place was enough, then pure leadership might be enough. But there are flaws in the way we tend to think about leadership, old last century thinking about leadership. So really, in my sense, in putting the two together, it's taking the best of both worlds. How do you do the uncommon thing, the unexpected thing? How do you have the openness to figure out what that is or what innovation you should follow or how you should adapt and still lead others to an end result that has a lasting impact to it, that actually creates value? That's what I see behind that term, rebel leadership.
I like it. It fits you. You're a rebel thinker, because you're a forward thinker. People could look at any concept and they don't know what to make of it. They don't even know the definition, but you put it in a trilogy. Thank you for sending me Rebel Leadership. That was wonderful.
My pleasure.
Good hope the audience, they would listen to this and they would gain the insight that you're sharing with them. Tell me, where can people find Rebel Leadership?
So the book officially comes out June 1. It can be pre-ordered on Amazon right now by just looking up Rebel Leadership or Rebel Leadership and Larry Robertson. And if they want to learn more about the book or more about me, my main website is the best source for that. And it's my initials, LRSpeaks.com. And the focus of the website is to give you a very quick and high-level sense of anything you want to know, whether it's one of the books, including Rebel Leadership, or it's what I do in the broader sense.
Excellent. I do thank you for coming on, and we'll see you again.
Thank you for having me. It was a pleasure.